Religion is inner ritualistic bath. Religion is inner search. You travel, pass on the road, gather dust. This can be cleansed very easily. Journeying through space and time, dust gathers on inner being. To cleanse this is not as easy as the dust from the physical body. Body is an outside dimension. Dust is outside. Water is there. The cleansing is easy. On the contrary, mind is within. So are the being and the consciousness. Also, the dust has gathered within like dross. The accumulated past, thoughts, unsettled emotions. How can these be cleansed by taking a ritualistic bath? What actually happens, not everyone can afford to go on a pilgrimage. If you have to go to a pilgrimage to Makkah Sharif, it requires money, the cost. Not everyone can afford that cost. Only those who have can afford to go. So most of the time when a person returns from the pilgrimage, his ego gets inflated. I said in most of the cases. Exceptions are always there. He feels that he has done something great which thousands of others have not been able to do. This becomes an obstruction. Each finite moment as you interact in the world of objects and beings, circumstances and situations keep on coming. And how do you react to these? How you interact? It's a better word to use. How you interact in a particular circumstance and situation. A stranger comes. A beggar stops you on the road for some money. How do you react? How do you interact with all these things? Each moment as you interact and there is a lack of awareness, you go on gathering dust, doing nothing, sitting silently, dust gathers. I have told you an example. Mind is like a pot. Even in inactivity, it gathers dust. The pots remain unused, washed in the cupboard or on top of the counter. Yet still these gather dust. Even in inactivity, the mind gathers dust. If you do nothing and just remain sitting, even then dust gathers and you will have to take a bath. Mind cannot stay quiet even for a few moments. The process of thoughts begin. Like a TV screen, the past events start surfacing. And then your channels are changed. The state of no mind is rare. Each thought and each action accumulates dust on consciousness. Outside cleansing and baths, howsoever ritualistic they may be, cannot remove dust from the mind and consciousness. For this, you have to search for inner water and inner techniques. It is said when you take a bath in holy Ganges, sins are washed. How can sin be washed? Sins are not performed by the act, by the body. Although actions take place at the physical level, but the guidance comes from that which is subtle. That which is subtle cannot be washed with water, a different kind of technique, and more so, and a deeper understanding is required. Deeper understanding is required, and if you are meditative, totally aware at the time when a particular word is being spoken or action is taking place, you are meditative, then it will not leave any residue. It will dissolve even during the process of that movement of thought or action. These sutras of Nanak, which are encompassed and known as Japji Sahib or Ekonkar Satnam, they are for inner search. They are very precious. Rightly understood, you will search the inner source of water that can cleanse all inner dust. This is the key for transformation. You seem to claim being in possession of many secrets or keys. Had it been so, you would have become aware. Each person claims that his scripture has all these things. But have you understood the scripture? You may know it like a parrot does. Even if you understand a single syllable, that is more than enough. For swimming, you need a vast surface area, a big swimming pool or a vast river. But you gain nothing. You remain on the surface and you feel relaxed. That's all and nothing happens. When you go to the beach, you take a bath, you swim for hour, half an hour or so, you feel relaxed. On the contrary, a diver needs only a limited space. A space which just allows him to enter into the water. He is not concerned with the surface. Instead, from one point, he makes an entry and starts going deeper and deeper into various realms of that same space. It does not matter whether you enter ocean from whatever side. The most important thing is that you enter the inner depth, and gems, precious gems, are found in the depth of the ocean, not anywhere, not on the surface. So for scriptures, understanding scripture, you need not be like a swimmer. Priests are like a swimmer. They know all these sutras, all the verses, everything they know. But the deeper meaning, they have not learned the art of drowning into the world. A single word is more than enough to transform your life. If you have heard half a line, and using that as an aperture, as an opportunity, you start diving into your being, that is more than enough. that is more than enough. And that is the most important aspect of this person who is on the inward journey. And because of your ego, you cannot accept that none of these keys are working in you. You have many keys. You know too much. And when you think that you know, problems gets accentuated. Then you go on carrying the burden of these unnecessary keys. Have any of these secrets worked for you? Introspect. You did this, you did that. Looking at your life, there is no such indication that either you do not have the correct key or you do not know how to use the key. The best way to use the key is choose a spot, choose a word, choose a sutra or whatsoever is as an aperture, as a place through which you drown into it. How that is possible? You are inflicted with the problems in your life relating to your lover, boyfriend, girlfriend, or boss, whosoever it is. Use that opportunity. Start going deep and deeper and deeper. It will be difficult. It will be painful. Somewhere or the other, as you enter deep, you will find there is something very precious about that person, that circumstance, that situation. We do not accept when the situation comes. After that, when it has happened, you realize had it not happened, you would have not have the doors open for another opportunity. But at that moment you had rejected it. If you had not rejected it, you would have had a totally a different kind of effect. You would not have to undergo the pain that you had undergone in the process of transformation. Now that you did not accept it in the first place, the pain has been there. Now the circumstances or the situations have made you bring about that change, but the memory of that continues to remain. Now introspect. Meditate over that particular circumstance and situation once again. You was very angry when you was to reach to the particular place at a time. I recall an incident. My father was living in a different city, and Sufi Brijmohan Lal was living in another city. My mother was staying at that time at her father's place. So it is quite natural in Indian environments that time that for a shorter period of time, maybe 2 weeks or 3 weeks, the wife would leave and go to her parents' house, stay there. So the monotony of staying with the beloved or the husband gets refreshed, and when you return is a new beginning. So my father was to go to that city to bring his wife back home. The date was wired. And it was, a date was fixed by the priest or whatsoever is, normally they look for the a blessed time, an auspicious time for such opportunities, such works. All of a sudden, Sufi Brijmohan Lal called one of his disciples and he said, "Why, Lallan Babu," that is how, that was his nickname, "and send him the date for sending the girl off with him is changed by 2 days." My grandmother said, "How would the in-laws react to that? Each time when a date is fixed, you bring your own criteria and change it." He said, "No, the date is changed by 2 days." When the wire reached my father, he was disagreed. He did not like, but he had no choice. My grandmother, his mother, did not like either. As if he is the boss and he dictates the term, whereas it is said the side of the girl supposed to be more humbled. But it did not happen. And you know what had happened? The train that my father was to travel on met a serious accident where the train lines are joined. They are known as fish plates, and someone loosened the nuts of those fish plates and it was an accident. When the train was passing over the bridge, the river bridge, the fish plates was removed. The nearly 5 or 6 compartments fell in the river, and when my father was passing through after 2 days, the debris was still being removed. My father did not accept it at that time. He missed the opportunity of the grace of the master. What is the wish of my master in changing the date? I know it not. Let me flow with it. And when it had actually happened, he realized that it was a blessing in disguise. This is the word we use. Blessing in disguise. If he had been traveling on those dates, which was initially fixed for his visit, was changed. This is how existence takes place. And this is how we do not accept a particular circumstance and situation when it is happening. A religious person is one on whose lips, like a ritual, like a thankfulness, a prayer words remain, "Let thy will prevail." It is my duty to flow with thy will. The leaf from the tree falls, tossing and turning, it settles on the ground. It is said Lao Tse was sitting and he saw a leaf of the tree separated from the tree, tossing and turning with the wind. It was moving up and down, moving far and wide, yet still finally it settled and on the ground as it fell. As it touched the ground, it settled. Something settled in Lao Tse and he became enlightened. You say that you have many keys, your scriptures are the greatest. Each custodian of the religion says that my religion is the best. You know too much And when you think you know, problem gets accentuated. Then you go on carrying the burden of these unnecessary keys. Have any of these secrets worked with you? Introspect. But looking at your life, it doesn't seem so. You continue to complain, but you never think even for a moment that it is the time to thank. How can this arise? None of these techniques that you claim to possess seem to be working. Remove all these keys. Nanak is speaking of the secrets or the key that really works. It is not that Nanak has that key. All Buddhas, be it Mahavir, be it Jesus, be it Zarathustra, be it Lao Tse, be it Kabir, they have found similar keys. Strangely enough, you go on carrying these keys that do not work. There is a master key that can unlock every lock. The master key seemed to be lacking. And that master key begins with introspection, begins with mindfulness, and it ends up in meditation. What can be the reason? The keys that you carry and claim to be religious are all non-operative. These cannot transform you. And why would ego want a transformation? As you are, it is your investment. Your investment is to be miserable, complaining for this and that, and you feel very happy, narrating your situation, how you got upset when that man told you something or that woman told you something. You are sitting, driving a posh car, but when you open your mouth, it does not come in conformity with the kind of a posh vehicle or the posh clothes that you are wearing. As you are, it is your investment. You remain as you are and you want to remain as you are. There is no danger with these keys. You remain as you are. Also, you can continue to claim your religiousness. You enjoy the possession of these keys and you escape the process of transformation. You do not listen to Nanak, Buddhas or anyone. Simple thing they tell you. Nothing very serious. They do not tell you to chant the scriptures. There is a danger in listening. Once you have listened to any of these words or even half a word, half a line, you cannot remain the same. Your ego claims, maybe, I am a learned, absolute learned, yet still I am learned. Maybe I have committed many mistakes. Is there anyone who has not committed mistakes in his life? In thousand ways, you try to convince yourself by saying to err is human being and so on and so forth. One thing your ego cannot accept, that you are ignorant. To accept your ignorance is the first criteria to move forward. And you go on giving excuses one after the other for your shortcomings, and will not accept that mistake was on your part. I see it on a day-to-day basis in dealing with the people. I just drown with him. And in every possible way you claim not to be ignorant. All kinds of arguments you put forward. Try to understand this. Whenever you commit a mistake, you try to save yourself, you criticize the action, you get angry, you consider this to be wrong, but you never say that you were angry. Instead, you blame the other as the cause of your anger. You consider anger is an action that has happened by coincidence. Maybe under the circumstance this has happened. You go on saving the doer. You never say that you are an angry person. You go on saying certainly mistakes do happen. This is the outcome of ego. You save yourself from the real key and the transformation. As soon as you use the real key, the first thing that happens is ego drops. And then all that you have accumulated so far proves futile. Until all your accumulation proves futile and ego vanishes, you will go on escaping the real key and the process of transformation as well. Poet Rabindranath Tagore has written a very meaningful poems. It reads, "For lives I have been searching and seeking God. In the process I traveled many paths, knocked so many doors, went to many masters and entered into austerities. And then one day I reached the door. Quite often all along the way, I did get a faraway glimpse near the star. And by the time I reached there, the star was no more. And today I have reached the abode. The nameplate is correct. Elated, I climbed the steps. I was about to knock at the door. And suddenly a fear grabbed me. If the door opens suddenly, what will I do? What will I do when God suddenly appears in front? That which was a destination up to now is no more destination. Up to now there was only one goal, and now this is appearing too. Now nothing is left, no journey, no future. Nothing else to do, nothing is left for the ego. An unknown fear gripped my being. I gently left the latch, so gently that it may not create any sound. I took off the shoes so that no sound may be there. Still shoes in my hand, I ran never to look back." And the last part of the poem reads, "Still I search his home. Certainly you will find me on different paths. I know this. I know his place. Still I go on asking people about his whereabouts. I know the address. Still I go on searching. I do get the glimpses far away in the stars. I search for him everywhere, but not where he really dwells. I fear that place and go on escaping. Ravindra is a master who expressed all his understanding, insights and inner development through his poems and plays. One can really feel an awe of something beyond through his works. This poem is unique and beautiful. If you really understand, this is your story. Never say even by mistake that you do not know God. This cannot be possible. God surrounds you. There is no way that you know not. Even by mistake, never say the lock is still there, because you do not know the key. Thousands of times you have been given the key, but always you leave the key somewhere and you forgot. Unconsciously you have been trying to save yourself. Unless this clears, you will search one moment and next moment you will miss the opportunity. You pretend this search. This satisfies that you are no ordinary person. This satiates your ego. There are many who go on searching for money, name and prestige in the world. But you are not like them. You are searching God. Words like these adorn your ego. These are to save, protect and decorate you, not dissolve your false identity. You rejoice this, you become a traveler along the path, while others remain engrossed in the finite. You go on saying on one hand that yours is real search, but deep within you go on saving yourself. It is like one who makes the house during the day and in the night destroys it. You put up one brick and then remove it. This has been happening for lives. Somewhere there is something intrinsically wrong. As a result, you go on walking in opposite directions. You go on carrying the bunch of false keys. None can open the lock. You take a ritual bath in the holy places. Such ritual baths cannot wash the dross from your mind. Your worship in the temples and all your holy places. You offer borrowed flowers that are offering of the plants at the altar of the divine, at the altar of the existence. Never have you offered yourself. You give donations, big or small, and do some religious works and thus save yourself. In Bhagavad Gita, there is a particular sutra that what are the requirements for prayer? Patram pushpam phalam toyam. Patra is the leaf, pushpa flower, phal fruit, and toyam water. Patram pushpam phalam toyam. What you do? You pick up a leaf from the nearby tree. You go to the shop, buy a fruit. You go and pick up the flowers from the tree. And you take the water. You are ready to go for the worship. And you say that you do your prayers every day. In Srimad Bhagavat Puran, one of the persons that is known as Bhishma, he has chosen the hour of his death. In the battle of Mahabharata, he was the greatest obstruction in the path of the victory of the Pandavas. So he was defeated. He is lying on the bed of arrows, waiting for the chosen hour for his departure. He wants Krishna to be in front of him. He cannot raise his hands. Just he tries to ask him to come in a vision that he can have a look at him. Then he says, I do not have a leaf. I do not have a flower. I do not have fruit. I do not have the water. Then he says, each part of my body, each of my actions, fruits of my actions, and water from my eyes is offered at your altar, at your feet. This is the way of a deeper understanding. Then he says, I want you to marry my daughter. Everyone knew Bhishma was unmarried. He has taken a vow not to get married. All the young ones are there, they surprised to hear how Bhishma is saying, offering his daughter to Krishna for acceptance. He says, my intellect is my daughter. Please accept him as your bride. Is it not a deeper understanding? You offer your daughter to, at the altar of the divine. Please accept my daughter. Who is the daughter? My intellect, my understanding, that have I am offering it to the divine. Such is the way of introspection. Another time, I will take the deeper meaning of this particular sutra from Bhagavad Gita.